Hello, good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to Radboud Reflect. This is already the fifth program of this new organization, which is formed out of the fusion of the Soeterbeek program and the Center of Ethics. We offer you reflections on the big questions of society and science of our time. The programs of Radboud Reflect are free to visit for students and employees of the university. My name is Dave Willems. I'm a programmer at Radboud Reflect, and today we're going to talk about TTIP. TTIP is a trade agreement which is being discussed behind closed doors in Brussels. It's a trade agreement between the United States and Europe. Supporters promise us big economic growth, but the critics fear that the notorious chlorinated chicken, I think Evert is going to talk about it, is coming to Europe and that big multinationals will get a lot of power in Europe. Professor Corporate Strategy Hans van Kranenburg will introduce the topic. But first, I have to say afterwards, we have a discussion between Maite Chonahi and Hans van Kranenburg. But first, we're going to listen to a column of a professor in social and political philosophy, Evert van der Zweden. Evert, the floor is yours.
This, ladies and gentlemen, is a so-called chloorkip. What I just did, chlorinating a chicken, is forbidden in the Netherlands. If, however, we let TTIP have its way, these critters are going to flood our fridges before you can properly spell genetically manipulated corn, which is what they get for lunch, if they are very lucky. We don't want these chloorkippen here, now do we? Keep your junk but nicely at your own. We don't want Amerikaanse toestanden. If you let Google translate this, you get American states, which suggests quite something else. You can also think of expressions like to be in a state, but still that doesn't catch the Dutch word wat een toestand. One can translate toestanden with conditions or situations or states of affairs, but none of it captures the Dutch word, which, depending on context, can be simply descriptive, but can also carry strongly negative, even desperate connotations, like just like gezellig, toestand is a highly idiomatic word. Just try to translate, wat een gezellige toestand is het hier. But in any case, we don't want them here, those American toestanden. A 17th century English philosopher, John Locke, famously wrote, in the beginning, the whole world was America. He was referring to pre-colonial America and suggested that prior to the invention of agriculture, private property, and cities, all humans had been living the kind of life that Native Americans were still living, wild, free, uncivilized. One easily sees how, from this image of the Native American, both the figure of the noble savage can arise, as well as the figure of the primitive soul that urgently needs to be converted to Christianity in order to be saved, but otherwise better be dead. America, for Locke, was a present that soon would be past. In the early 19th century, another philosopher, George W. Hegel, just as famously wrote that America was the land of the future. Amerika ist somit das Land der Zukunft. He didn't really know what to think of Russia, and he didn't even mention China or BRIC countries. But about America, he wrote, es ist ein Land der Sehnsucht für alle die, welche die historische Rüstkammer des alten Europa langweilt. Napoleon soll gesagt haben, cette vieille Europe m'ennuie. For Hegel, America was part of what he called die germanische Welt, an expression that is often misunderstood. Nothing was farther from Hegel than German chauvinism. Germany, by the way, didn't even exist. And he did not mean German, but Germanic, including the Netherlands, France, Scandinavia, and the Anglo-Saxon world, including also North America, which was then partly French. Louisiana had been sold in 1803, but French was still widely spoken, of which place names like Baton Rouge, Lafayette, Des Moines testify. America, North America, which was largely, of course, British, but with some Dutch elements as well. Brooklyn, Harlem, Wall Street. For Hegel, there was no world beyond the Germanic world, at least not one he could now conceptualize. And he sensed that its key ideas, the key ideas of this Germanic world, would continue to conquer the world. This led his Russian-French commentator, Alexander Kozhevnikov, also known as Alexander Kozhev, and his late 20th century Japanese-American avatar, Francis Fukuyama, to develop a position that articulates the exact opposite of John Locke's. In the end, the whole world will be America. Indeed, in the 20th century, the USA have come to dominate the world politically, militarily, and economically. This has had a strong impact on the so-called old world, where not everybody enjoys this process. Americans, as we know, generally fail to understand why the rest of the world hates them. And indeed, on an individual level, it's often hard to hate them. Many Americans are quite likable persons. This proves Carl Schmitt right, who held that the enemy is not the person whom I hate, but simply the person who stands in my way, or who wants to impose his will onto mine, and of my allies. America, then, stands for what Europeans reject, yet of course strongly desire. The cocky French, in particular, fear Americanization as much as they fear European Union food policies. And they insist on saying ordinateur instead of computer. They insist on saying gestion instead of management. And strangely, they insist on saying frites instead of French fries. We, who say patat or frites, neither of which is Dutch, like to think of ourselves as more liberal. And indeed, we have already traded much of our native language for a mixture of Dunglish and gaming slang. But we, too, don't want Amerikaanse toestanden. We rather hold it out of the door. Have they now completely crazy become? On my body, no Polonaise. From this angle, resistance against TTIP may seem as a natural, anti-American, even traditional European reaction. But if we return to good old Hegel for a second, we see that what comes to us from the USA is a boomerang that we tossed into the air ourselves. It's part of the same Germanic world. It's a cookie of own Tao. Besides, both for US Americans who come to Europe and for Europeans who visit the USA, it is clear that not only is Europe becoming more American, but America is also becoming more European. This concerns not only food, where the main difference is that American portions are always bigger, but also things like clothes. A mere 30 years ago, you could both see and smell US American tourists from a distance. And a mere 20 years ago, you could easily tell the Europeans from the Americans at international conferences. Checkered pants and broad ties were sure Yankee signature. Most of this has disappeared. Some call it globalization. And indeed, TTIP, the Transatlantic Trade and Investment Partnership, is part of that. But before we start accusing Americans once again of spoiling our good taste and our supreme sense of quality, we might stop and ask ourselves what's really going on here. What's going on is the liberalization of trade and investment, the mutual opening of markets, including financial ones, which will make it possible, both in the US and in the EU, to import products that cannot be legally produced within one's own economic sphere. Chlorinated chicken are one example, but there are countless other examples of products that have the low prices they do as a result of the violation of animal rights or of production under label conditions that are illegal elsewhere. Nor is it a European privilege to be concerned about this. Americans fear EU-made toys that do not meet the stricter US safety standards. The obvious next step is that European producers cross the Atlantic to produce there what they are not allowed to produce here, and vice versa. You don't have to tell an entrepreneur on which side his sandwich is buttered, now do you? So, will the whole post-TTIP world be America? Perhaps, folks, we should not let ourselves be fooled again. Let's not have us sold turnips for lemons. There's nothing American about a chlorine chicken, nothing Indian about the money that buys Dutch steel mills, nothing Qataris about the money that purchases artworks for the Guggenheim Museum in Doha. French fries are no more French than French kissing is. So there's nothing American about Amerikaanse toestanden. We're talking about, straight and simple, the next step in a process of deregulation and liberalization that, as a phenomenon, is indeed global, but it's not American. Surely, neoliberalism spread from Chicago, but wasn't it invented by Austrian economists Friedrich von Hayek, Ludwig von Mises? And wasn't it popularized by a Russian novelist, Alisa Zinovyevna Rosenbaum, also known as Ayn Rand? If being American stands for being ready to let yourself be fooled around by politicians from the very moment they are elected, then, yes, the whole world is America. The real problem with TTIP is political, the fact that the agreement was reached at the level of the executive only. TTIP epitomizes the depoliticization of, in this case, the economy. The transfer of vital decisions to the level of governance, combined with the transfer of entire domains, such as agriculture or finance, from the public to the private domain. Not keeping, but taking them out of the political. What United States and European Union citizens have in common is that no one ever asked them about TTIP. What they might share is protest and uprising against that situation. It's not about TTIP as such, it's about the politics behind it. After all, TTIP might be a very good idea if only EU countries would adopt strict US regulations for toys and their safety, while the US would adopt the EU legislation on labor conditions or a ban on chlorinating chicken.
Thank you very much for the inspiring
poem. I'm a little bit curious. Both of you know what TTIP is? Okay. And the ones that know TTIP, who's in favor of TTIP? Okay, there are a few. Against? Okay. And has no opinion? Okay. Well, it's really nice to see that, you know, we have a nice audience that part is in favor of TTIP and all not. So, what is it, TTIP? Well, you already hear that, you know, it's the transatlantic trade and investment partnership between the EU and the United States. When did it start? It started in July 2013. And why did it start? Because before that time, different countries in the world thought about, you know, we should liberalize, we should have fair trade, we should abandon all this protectionism. But what we find out is that it didn't work out. The negotiations were failed, and then the EU and United States say, okay, well, we should come up with a treatment, because we believe in it. And given all the developments that we see, is that fair trade will definitely help an increase in welfare, not only in the EU and America, but if you do it in the right way, then you also see an increase in welfare of the whole world. It also has a definitely effect on prices. And what does it mean, TTIP? Actually, it's an agreement where you try to reduce the tariffs, import and export tariffs, reduce protectionism. That means subsidies. You try to abandon them. Because actually that's what you see nowadays in the world, is that one sector is subsidized against another sector. Is that fair? No, if you really think about, you know, fair competition. Also about standards. Well, in the column we already hear about the standards. The toys, a very interesting one. Because actually that's also what you try to do. You try to harmonize the standards. So, and also in that aspect, you try to create fair competition. And that also helps organizations when they enter the markets, sell the products. And when you buy the product, then you also know that you buy the product under certain conditions. So that's actually what the aim is of this treatment. And to give you a nice example, what are the benefits of this? Is that when you look at the airline companies, well, all of you have some experience with flying, going to America, isn't it? Is it possible for a European company to fly within US? No, why? Yeah, that's right, it's protected. So there are landing slots, and these landing slots are owned by the government. And the US government decided, okay, foreign companies are not allowed to fly in the US. Well, if you say, okay, well, we try to liberalize the market, then it also gives an opportunity for the European airline companies to fly in the US. Instead of now, you know, you need a partnership in a US company to have the connections in the US. So this is one example. Another one is when you think about, you know, the energy debate that we have. Is there a certain restriction on cars export from the US? Do you know it? There is. Because the Americans, they have a limitation on the amount of cars that they can be exported. Well, now if you look at the EU, we have the discussion about cars. We are really, for nowadays, we are dependent on Russia. We have a debate now with Russia. And what you see is that it definitely also has effect on our import of cars and also the energy prices. This treatment, if you have that, should also abandon quotum for cars for the US. And that means we can also import cars from the US to Europe. Another example, another one, is that if you also look at the industry that we have, the dredging industry, the bagger industry, they are not allowed to operate in the US. And as for Van Lens, it's a very important industry. So, you know, if you look at the competitive advance of this industry in the world, well, we are the leading industry. Or we have the leading companies in this industry. Now we are not allowed to operate in the US. Then we should be allowed to operate. Another one is about, you know, think about the high-tech industry. The high-tech is also very well protected in the United States. Because if they determine it's a strategic asset for the United, for the American economy, then we are not allowed to acquire that asset. And, well, what we also know is that, well, for the near future, if we would like to be competitive against Asia or Latin America, then we should invest in technology, in innovation. R&D is very important. And we also know that the United States is leading in it. Well, if you look at the infrastructure, the institutional context, venture capitalists are there. Well, if you now go to the financial institution in Europe, it's really difficult to get some finance for your project. In the US, it's quite easy. So that means also, if you are part of that partnership, that means also you have a much easier access to capital. And that capital really stimulates entrepreneurs, come up with new innovations. And that's actually what we need. So there are also some few examples of how important this can be, to have this treatment. So to have fair trade, to stimulate economic activities, but also what we know is for economic activities, we also definitely see an increase in welfare. And if you have an increase in welfare, it also increases stability. Because that's also what we know, and that's also very important. But there's also some other issue. All of you are using internet. You are not using internet? Interesting. But we all use Google. We all use Microsoft. And we all had to sign an agreement, isn't it? Otherwise, you are not allowed to use it. Who of you signed the agreement? Almost all of you. Who read the agreement? It's about 90 pages, isn't it? And actually, what's so interesting is, you should read that agreement. Because actually it's written down that only the US citizens are protected by the US government. And we are talking about US companies. So actually we are not protected. And that's also what we saw with the debate about the NSA. Because the Americans are protected, we are not. And this agreement will also help us that we are protected under the American law. Or the European law, but if Google or Microsoft is doing something, is violating our property rights, then immediately you can sue them. Now we cannot do it because we know we are not protected. So this is also an example why this is so important. And the final example that I have is Salman Oxley. You know, the LIBOR issue at the financial institutions. Well, the main issue was in the United States. Also, good behavioral firms is settled in the law in the US, the Salman Oxley Act. So actually what you see, and that is something that we don't realize, is that, you know, if you do some activities with US firms or in the US, we have to follow that act. If you are not doing that, you know, you can be sued. And a really nice example is, for instance, a few years ago, one of the top managers of British Airways had to go to jail in the US. So he was living in London, and the Americans say he is violating our law. Well, actually British Airways, but he's responsible for that. So UK, please, could you send him to the US so that he had to go to prison? And so he was in prison for 6 months. We don't have that in Europe. If you look at, you know, we have the mismanagement, we have a lot of discussion about that. In the US, you have it. So there you see that, you know, it's all not only black and white, but there are all really nice opportunities. And of course, there are also criticism on this treatment. You want to mention it, the nice chicken, genetic modified products. But what is also really important is that, you know, we are talking about negotiation. It's not the treaty, it's not there yet. But what is also is that the European Parliament already mentioned in it for that this agreement should not have negative effect on our standards. And that's a very important one, because we are not in favor of genetic modified products. I'm not sure, to be honest. I know that it's in the law, and it happened when the American company, Monsanto, started to reform the organization and decide, okay, let's go in the field of life science. And then they found out that, you know, in the US, it's allowed to have a GMO. And then they found out in Europe, it's not. But what we now see also is that there's now, in the US, what we see is a debate is started about GMO. Because now the people are informed. And now they are really thinking, well, is this really good for us? But in Europe, you also see another movement. And that's the newspaper of today. This is the regional newspaper, the Gelderlander. And I was reading this the morning, and then what I found out is that, you know, we're also doing some research about GMO. It's from the Wageningen University, and actually we're also seeing, you know, is it possible to reduce the diseases of, for instance, potatoes? So we are not realizing that we also are investigating in GMOs. But the main question is, okay, is that if we say, okay, we should not adapt GMOs, then we should protect it. But that's part of the negotiation, say to the US, okay, you should not reduce our standards. So that's one of the criticisms. But we also have to realize is that, you know, it's not only the US that is doing research in that, but also, in this case, the Dutch organizations. And other one is the investor-to-state disputes settlement. And that's also a very interesting one, because what I propose is that, you know, an investor can start a lawsuit against the state. But then you need an independent authority. And then we are saying, wait a minute, we also have some independent authority by the state, because they are sovereign. How are we dealing with that? Well, we already found a solution for that, and that's I don't know the solution yet, because I couldn't find it, but it's part of the negotiation, and that's that Europe will not accept this settlement. So they also have to come with something else. But publicity is good, because that's what you need also for the negotiations. But I would say, okay, it's better for our welfare that we have this treaty, also for the stability, and also... what I would say is that we already have experience with these kind of treaties. Of course, the European Union is also a treaty like this. We also started with such kind of free trade agreement. And then later on, it moved into the European Union. And now we are thinking about, you know, is it possible to create a political union? It's one step further. So in this case, I would also say, okay, we have to start at the beginning, so the free trade, and then have some agreements, and then based on that, see, you know, what should be the next steps. So this is what I would like to say about the TTIP.
Okay, Hans, thank you very much. We're running a bit late, so I'll just ask you one question and then I'll give you the floor, because I'm sure you all have questions too. I'd like to return to the problem Evert ended with in his column, because I think that's one of the main problems as well, and that is the place where this treaty is being reached, which is not at a political level. There's a lot of corporate involvement, a lot of lobbyist involvement, and you describe it in your introduction as a morally neutral treaty. Okay, there are some differences, but we'll have a normal, objective debate about it, and then we'll get to some understanding. But I think that's not the case, and I think you know it as well, that there's a lot of corporate interference. And I'd like to know from you, do you think that there is a possibility to an honest debate, or is it one-sided, and is the debate held at the right place right now?
Yeah, you always have interference of companies.
Yeah.
What's really nice is that sometimes we don't realize is that if you go to the European Union, then you also see a lot of lobbyists, and actually most of the lobbyists are financed by multinationals. So also that policy is really influenced, but we always had that. But what's so nice is that we also have different parties with different ideologies, opinions, etc. So that will definitely help in the negotiation process, because then you have different perspectives.
Okay.
I have to admit that there's one danger, and perhaps that's good to emphasize, is that there's a difference if you look at, well, we call it the non-market strategy, and that is that in Europe, it's not allowed that companies finance campaigns of political parties. Mm-hmm. In the US, it is. And actually, what you then see is that when you have these campaigns, then all these large organizations are financing the campaigns. And then when the government is sitting there, then say, wait a minute, we finance you, we supported you, so now you have to support us. So that definitely will influence.
Yeah, but do you think that it's really only a difference in perspective? Because if we have a debate about genetic modification, and on one side we have farmers here,
yeah,
and on the other side we have Monsanto, which has like billions of lawyers and billions of dollars to finance these lawyers. Isn't the debate like, isn't the outcome of the debate already solid beforehand?
No, definitely not. Because okay. Monsanto is a very nice one, because when they started with the GMOs, mm-hmm, it was a reaction in Europe that influenced the politicians and say, okay, well, you have to come with some legislation. And then it was in the European Union that they decide, okay, well, we should forbid GMOs. So okay, you can definitely have influence on that.
I have more questions, but I'd like to give you all the floor. Yeah. Wait a second, because the mic is coming your way. Yeah.
Yes, testing. Thank you. I would like to say in good Dutch that your story is a gatenkaas. You do a lot of cherry picking, and even the examples you pose as favorable, I would say, are very harmful. I would like to, it's too many to note, but let me give me some examples from the NAFTA agreement, the North American Free Trade Agreement between Mexico, Canada, and the U.S. It's a similar agreement. You say it's, labor laws are protected. They're not. Mexican laborers are forced to work at very low wages. The Mexican drug war is a part, a consequence of that. Labor is flowing into America to find jobs. The country is disrupted. For Canada, great pieces of nature are fully destroyed because companies can, since NAFTA, excavate tar sands. It's a huge environmental disaster. Even when there was protest against this globalization in Toronto in Canada, there was American police who said they stood above the Canadian police and they arrested Canadian citizens. So it is globalization, but it is not a very favorable globalization. What you said about publicity, finally there is publicity. Yes, of course, they never sought publicity. They all decided behind closed doors. So the publicity was there because of activist groups who brought it on the table and not because they like to share it with us.
Could you form this to a question eventually?
Okay, yeah. Free flow of capital. You say free flow of capital is a positive thing. And you say that also about EU is already this far. We see what free flow of capital does with Europe and what it has done with the economy. Free flow of capital is not positive. I could go on, but I have to finish. So my question would be, how can you defend this with cherry-picking some positive highlights? Well, you can. I know you can see what this treatment is really about.
Okay.
Thank you. Well, thank you very much. well, you can always look at it from the bright side of life or the other perspective. Of course, there are also disadvantages and negative effects. That's also what I mentioned. But we also have to be honest, and let me say the phrase in this way. If you look at the European Union, look at, you know, after the Second World War, we decided to start the European Union. We would like to, well, the reason was stability, self-sufficient, etc. And look at now. Look at our welfare. And of course, there are still struggles. No.
Welfare, really? Oh my God, I'm
so, that's all right. Well, if you see what we achieve in that period, it's amazing. We are sitting here. We have the mobile phones. We could invest in technology, etc. So it had definitely huge advantage. Now, and that's also what we will definitely have with the EU. That particular treatment. I'm really convinced about it. Because that's also what we see. We also see, and that's something that we should realize, is what kind of order do you then prefer? Because this is an order that is working. We see that, you know, companies are very innovative. They really help us. They increase welfare, what I mentioned, stability, education level. We can finance education level. All these kind of things.
Yes? One second, you'll get a mic. Yeah.
I'm very ignorant about everything, but you mentioned companies. I don't understand how companies should help us to improve our education and our healthcare. Sorry.
What we are doing is the companies, is that's what you see is that, you know, first of all, think about innovation. And that's what Schumpeter was saying, is that, you know, you should stimulate entrepreneurs, because entrepreneurs are coming with innovations, radical innovation, and these radical innovations will definitely help us to make the next step.
Sorry, I repeated the question. What is the relation with public goods as education and hospitals and so on?
Of course, if you look at hospitals, if you look at the organizations, look at, you know, what kind of devices that they have. They are developed by organizations. Think about, you know, organizations like Philips, what they did, because now they have a very strong health division. They come with the new devices. We can do research on that, and we can help people. Most of them are coming from the organizations.
Yeah, but then the difference maybe is when you talk about the European Union, we were talking about a political treaty amongst countries, which was formed by politicians. And now we are talking about this big gray area where maybe we have to say the power is not with the politicians or with the people who chose the politicians, but with the large corporations.
It was always. It's an obvious combination.
Okay. Yeah, okay, okay, okay.
Let me clear about that. What is really, for these kind of treaties, two comments I have. First of all, is that, you know, these treaties, you need politicians for that, because they are the ones that make the treaties, mm-hmm. and not the companies. Because companies can only inform and
the politicians. And actually, that's also what is happening. And then also, what is really important, it's really nice when you talk about negotiations, then what we always know is that, you know, when you can do negotiations, well, you have to be transparent, etc. Well, we know that if you're very transparent with a negotiation at the beginning, then it will not work, because then there are so many people that are involved and they have their own opinion, and that will definitely influence the whole process, and at the end, you will not come to an agreement. So what you always see is that there are always parts, and that's also happening in the European Union, that, you know, government officials, politicians are negotiating with each other, and then later on, you know, are the prime ministers or the state ministers that are signing the contract or doing the final, or making the final negotiation.
We have a question in the back, and then I'll come back to you, and if we still have time to you, but I'm not sure. Yeah.
Thank you very much. I find this entire perspective coming from the front to be a complete whitewash. The idea that Europe is doing well is a fantasy. We're living in crisis. Greece is being destroyed as we speak. We have hundreds of thousands of refugees knocking on our borders, and living standards within the European Union have not increased even before the start of the most recent crisis. TTIP is a very difficult subject to tackle, especially within 45 minutes. I'm part of an organization called the International Socialists, who are organizing a more in-depth discussion on the 15th of September. We'll be standing outside with flyers where you can talk about... My question is coming. So we can move past this nonsense about TTIP being some kind of wonderful free trade agreement. Companies being able to sue governments is madness. This is a discussion about democracy. And the European Union has always had a problem with democracy, as has been admitted from the front. And now the solution isn't to continue in that direction, but to dial it back and go for some real democracy so that the people that live in the European Union and that live within the US can actually decide what the country is going to look like. My question is, do you believe that once the negotiations are finished, that the European citizens and the United States citizens should be able to vote on whether or not it would be implemented? Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Partly it will happen, because it's the European Parliament that should approve this agreement. So that means indirectly, yeah, the voters have a choice.
Okay.
So you're against referenda in general?
That's a political statement.
That's a question.
Oh, well, no. Then you can have a nice debate, because you can have a referendum. But that's I will not say anything about it, because that I would say that's a political statement. But the only reaction I will have is that, well, if you are for democracy and we are saying, oh, you have the European Parliament and we are electing the members of the European Parliament, and they are the ones, that just like democracy that we have, for instance, have in the Netherlands, they are the ones that agree with the treaty or not.
Sorry, there was... Well...
He asked whether you wanted
that
European people to vote. You didn't answer that question.
Do you think it's desirable?
But that's a really personal opinion. And for me, then my answer is really clear, because then I say it's the European Parliament.
Okay, we'll have one last...
But that's always for all the treaties.
We have a question here.
In the beginning you said you will be more protected using the internet. And I'm wondering, because wasn't the whole thing about the discussion about the protection of the internet caused by the collecting data by the NSA? Mm-hmm. So in the end, if we give them more power, wouldn't that be a problem?
I was thinking the same way. You said you said we are not protected by the US government, and I thought, aren't we better off? But
because actually, didn't they brought European laws by collecting data? So if we give them the rights to collect them, well, they don't break any laws anymore, because we just give them the rights to break... To don't break laws, because we don't have them anymore, I think.
Your question is clear.
And that's clear. Then I go back to the treaty. then also what the European Parliament mentioned is that, you know, we have our standards, and if they affect, if the effect is negative on our standards, then we will not agree.
Yeah, sorry, there was one person before you, so final question.
You said that European Parliament said our standards are guaranteed, but at the end, will they still be guaranteed? Because an investor can say, oh, it doesn't matter what you have said, juridically we have the possibility to sell our products in Europe. We don't care about your standards.
Well, what we have is for certain products, you need approval. Otherwise, you are not allowed to sell the products. That's with medicines, for instance. For food, you also have that. So in that sense, it will always be protected. And then if, but that's what normally happens, if they set certain products on the market, and then we say, okay, well, they are not the standards, then we always can go to court. Because then you can say, okay, well, it's not safe, etc. And then there should be a decision by the court, or they should create a law. But that's happening now also, so I don't see that a really big issue.
Well, we still have time for one question. Yes, the guy in the middle, yeah.
Hello. I had a question regarding the practicality of TTIP. One of the arguments I've heard is that this has become a very large elephant they're trying to fit through the front door. Mm-hmm. And that by, in particular, trying to harmonize all these different standardizations, which U.S. authorities and European authorities have spent decades building up in completely different ways, they've actually made this entire treaty completely unworkable. Do you believe that there is a chance for this treaty in its current form, in its current capacity, to ever even possibly be implemented?
And that's also what I mentioned at the end, is that, you know, you have different stages in the whole process. And if you ask me, then I would say, okay, it's too complex now. So first start, you know, have a simple agreement. If that is working, then you go to the next steps, just like the way we build up the European Union. So
I think TTIP in its current form will not pass, basically. Because it's become too complicated.
It may be, yeah. Because they expect that, or at least that was what they hope is that they will finish or they sign the contract in November 2016. Well, you know how these processes go. So.
But still as one treaty, so not a different treaty for toys and a different treaty for Gentech. And
No, one treaty, but then you can decide, then, okay, well, these are the sectors that we have a treaty on. And then if that's working, then you go to the next stage. So that's my answer. So I believe in it, but I also understand the complexity and also the political influences. And given, well, the best way to implement this, make it as simple as possible and then work it out further.
Break it up and piece by piece. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. I'm sorry, but we'll have to leave it at this. Thank you, Hans. I think it was a very difficult subject to tackle, and I think we can all agree that we disagree here. So I'll just leave it to Dave to say some final words.
I'll just keep it to some practical remarks. Well, first of all, thank you, Hans van Kranenburg, Evert van der Zweden, and Matthijs Chonayi. This is part of our kickoff weeks of Radboud Reflect. Tonight we have a big lecture of psychiatrist and philosopher Damian Denise in the lecture building. I thought it sold out, but we have a video room in which you can also look at the lecture. Next week we have a lecture of Stine Jensen, and for more information you can visit our website www.ru.nl/Radboud Reflects. Thank you for your attention. Have a nice afternoon.